I will try to give you a short description of what Indigo Data Cloud project is building. It will be very high level, and I will not put so much details on each of the technology and services developed, because most of those services and technology will be better described, and also you will have some demos and hands-on on the next hours and days. So starting from the next presentation is in the agenda, and also the afternoon and all tomorrow, you will see a lot of concrete details on how all those services are implemented and how they work. So my duty here is to give you an overall view of what the project is and which kind of platform we are thinking in order to help scientists community to build their own science. So going to the second slide, just a brief introduction about the project. It is a European-founded project in the Cole Infra 1-2014, and it was started April 2015. It will end in September next year, because it's a year-long project. It is a very huge effort, both in terms of money invested by European Commission, and both in terms of partnership and distribution around Europe. So we have 26 European partners and 11 countries involved. Obviously, as the name already tells, is mostly related to cloud and data analysis. So we are trying to put on the ground a cloud platform that is able to let the scientists do their data analysis. So it's perfectly intended and architected in order to let the scientists exploit that. So it's not a general way of giving cloud services. It's perfectly targeted for the scientific communities. And indeed, we start from the requirement coming from the European community of scientists in a lot of different areas, starting from structural biology or science or physics, bioinformatics, even cultural heritage, astrophysics, etc. So a lot of peoples and a completely different group of researchers are providing us specific technological and scientific requirement in order to focus and to steer our development. So it's something that starts from the needs of the users. It's not providing technology just because we like the technology, but they start from the requirement, and then going back to the technology, try to find out which services, which components are really needed by each of the community, and so try to bring together and to make a coherent platform that could be used by any of those scientific community. But already we are targeting scientific community that are not listed in the project since the beginning, because obviously if the platform is general as we want to be, we should be able to serve also diverse community. So we started from our perception of what is missing the already available cloud technology. And by incident, we found that we are not alone in these thoughts. And we see that, for example, the European Commission in this paper that we are listed here, it's somehow telling the same that we are thinking before. So they are already stressing the fact that in many cloud technology, there is a technological gap that should be filled. For example, from point of view of the interoperation, or from point of view of the multi-tenancy, so the isolation, the capability of providing isolation when needed, or for example in terms of elasticity and dynamic allocation of resources and all other stuff. So which kind of gap we try to fulfill in the already available cloud technology? Mainly we are focusing in providing redundancy and reliability for both services or application executed over the cloud, together with the capability to provide to those applications or services, they needed elasticity in terms of scalability. So basically, you can exploit the number of resources you need exactly instead of allocating those resources before ahead and need to somehow pre-fetch resources in some way, manually or whatever. Also monitoring the resource utilization of those resources. And so both the site admin and user are happy with the share of usage of resources and the dynamic allocation of resources. Obviously, one important thing is avoid a commercial provider, but also in terms of technology. You should be able to change the technology underneath, also if it's open source, without worrying of building again from scratch the full platform. So just to give you an example, we should be able to deploy any kind of software or services we have, both on OpenStack or OpenNebula, in a very transparent way from the user point of view. So the end user should not know which kind of cloud technology we are exploiting. And this means that we are avoiding any kind of blocking. And also, the application is somehow already there. We cannot think that the end user will rewrite all the application they have just because the cloud is smart or the cloud is trendy. We should try to move all the application we have in the cloud in the more seamless way as possible. And so a lot of application and a lot of services is perfectly intended to solve this kind of problem. Obviously, as we are dealing about science and data analysis, we really need big data, analyzing big data, exploiting HPC resources and whatever. Differently from the past experience, don't want to reinvent all the wheels, because we already know that there are a lot of projects that are there producing good software and perfectly usable technology. So we want to have anything is already there, improve it if and when it's needed. And as soon as we do some kind of improvement or addition from the point of view of the feature, we should push this into the project back again, so that it's automatically maintained also after the end of the project and if the developer is gone. Because obviously, this means that solution, that services, is sustainable for the futures, and the scientists and community could leverage those services for a very long time in the future without worrying about what is about the data cloud. Obviously, we are not alone in the world, both in terms of project and infrastructure. So we know about a lot of other projects that are dealing with the science or with the technology, and we are collaborating very closely with them, both in terms of scientific community. As you can see in the slide, a lot of infrastructure is somehow joining the project or working with us in order to have their use cases in our platform. So Elixir, WMR, or I don't know, Eurobioimaging or whatever, but also in terms of infrastructure. We are working closely with DGI, with UDAT, with ARC, and PRAISE too, in order to have solutions that are somehow interoperable, that can work together, and at the end user could exploit the services where they are available, not worrying about, oh, okay, this is Indigo only platform, I cannot use anything about UDAT anymore because I'm shifting to Indigo. So we want to have a solution where any kind of services could be plugged in and could be interoperable. For example, before I had, someone is asking if I can bring my own services or my own software here. Surely you can, you should try to have this kind of mixing environment, because this is absolutely welcome and this is good for anyone to work together. Obviously, as a project, we are working with a work package approach, and free work packages is specifically devoted to develop services, both at the level of infrastructure as a service, WP4, that is dealing about resource virtualization, or at the level of platform, so federation, automatism, etc. That is WP5, and at the level of portals, toolkit, interfaces, that is WP6. In the next talks, in these 2 days, you will see mostly things coming out from WP6 and WP5, because the functionalities and the services that are at the level of IIS usually are not so visible from the end user. They are mostly devoted to the cloud providers in order to improve the reliability, the performance, and whatever at the level of IIS, but you are already exploiting them without even knowing that there is some advantages in using Indigo specific IIS instead of the general one. So it's something giving you for free without even knowing that you are exploiting them. And then we have a work package devoted to the collaboration with the resource community, and then obviously the software management and pilot services WP3. So this is a very simplified sketch of our overall platform. As you may see, it's quite complex, also if we try to simplify a lot the interaction and the number of services. Mostly in the bottom of the picture, you will see services coming from the resource virtualization layer, so basically the IIS part. And with the yellow box. With the red box, you will see most of the services that are devoted to provide PaaS-like features with federation of storage and computing, brokering of cloud resources, authentication, and other stuff that I will describe better in the next slides. And then obviously the upper layer, it's mostly devoted to toolkit interfaces, portals, and similar technologies. So starting from the bare metal, here in the next 2 slides, I will list some specific features that we are working on from the point of view of infrastructure as a service. As we are obviously targeting only open source software, from the point of view of the infrastructure as a service, we are working on OpenStack and OpenNebula, because obviously they are quite close to our community and we can put hands on and change the code and provide this code to the upstream of the projects, both. For example, one of the most important achievement is try to improve the scheduling capability of both OpenStack and OpenNebula in order to allocate resources. If you know what is a batch system, you know that you can have a kind of share or priority in exploiting batch resources. This is not already available in the cloud, but we are pushing new services and code in order to explicitly provide those features, so that you can ask for a cloud resources and you may have a very similar behavior to what is before I had in the batch system. So your request is put in a queue and your request will follow the definition of quality of service or share or whatever that your infrastructure provider is giving to you. So you may have a very golden and fast and quick response, or you can just stick in the queue as soon as some free resources is available, you will get that. So this is a very important implementation that we are working on. It's very close to be released officially. From the point of view of the orchestration, if you have any experience on exploiting directly a given IIS, you know that there are a lot of steps that you need to do in order to have a full running service. So you need to ask for a virtual machine, to plug some disk on top of it, to configure the network, to start the services, to configure the services or whatever. All those steps could be orchestrated, could be somehow automated in a way that the user is not worried about any of those steps. Both OpenStack and OpenNebula has some features that give the possibility to orchestrate resources, but we are working in order to harmonize the languages that we are using in order to do this orchestration. So now we are stick with the Tosca, that is a standard, and it is a widely used languages. So you may use OpenStack or OpenNebula, and you don't change any comma in your template. So it's perfectly running, the same template is perfectly running on one infrastructure or the other in a very transparent way. In the next slide, we are also looking to the storage technology. We are also improving the capability of describing which kind of requirement you have from the storage perspective. So you may ask for a very reliable storage and a very cheap one, like registering those files on a tape that will stay for 10 years, and we will not lost data, but it will not be so fast because you just don't need that file every day. Or you may do the opposite one, asking for staging them in a very performant SSD disk for a limited amount of time. So these kind of features are somehow already available on the commercial cloud provider, if you look at Amazon Glacier or Google Cloud Storage, etc. But it was not in the open source cloud technology. We are exactly filling this gap, so that also in open science, open source cloud environment, you may ask for quality of services in terms of storage capabilities. Also, from the network perspective, we are improving the capability of both OpenStack and OpenNebula in order to fulfill requirement about isolation or building up VPNs or spanning the same network on different sites, etc. Also, as we are dealing with the science, most of the time you need performance very close to what the bare metal is able to do. And the best way to exploit this is container running on bare metal. So we are improving the transparency of using a container in a cloud environment so that the user can push their container into a public Docker Hub repository. This will be automatically available at the level of IIS without asking anything, and just run your application in a very transparent way with the maximum performance, and maybe exploiting, I don't know, InfiniBand or GPU card or whatever you need in your application environment. So this is most of the most important services at IIS level. From the layer of the platform as a service, I will go much faster here because you will have a more detailed view in the afternoon about those services, and also tomorrow about the search part. Mostly, we are improving the capability of exploiting in a geographical environment the cloud resources. So you can ask to a single federation of sites to deploy your services, asking for certain amount of resources or certain configuration of the IIS or whatever, closest to the data that you have, or any kind of different requirement that you may have. From the point of view of the brokering, the path layer is able to broker across different resources from the point of view of the computing and storage, and so let the people know, exploit automatically which is the solution that fit better its requirement. From the point of view of the interfaces, again, we try to use a standard way of assessing software or resources. Again, here the means is a Tosca template that is standard definition, and so that the user could define requirements in terms of software, in terms of dependency, and so you can have a very complex way of describing your cluster or your needs in terms of application. And this is somehow quite general. It could be used across any kind of cloud solution. Even using the PaaS layer, even you can exploit, I don't know, Amazon or Google. And this is completely transparent to the end user. So the PaaS layer is taking care to translate this high-level definition of cluster of services into something that is understandable by Amazon, by OpenStack, by Google, and whatever, in a very transparent way from the end user perspective. From the point of view of the storage, the slide 11, we are building a data federation that is able to provide you the capability to share any kind of storage solution. So you can exploit POSIX file system, you can exploit object storage, you can exploit different kind of vendors storage technology, and then you get a unique federation layer where all your files is somehow accessible also via a standard POSIX environment. But you can, if you want, also exploit high-level features like quality of services I was describing before. So you have a very high grade of flexibility, and you can express your needs in terms of storage in a very high-level way with web interfaces and all those kind of stuff. You will be also able to share your file from your desktop in a very easy way, like Dropbox or whatever, and then push those files into the cloud, keeping synchronized with your desktop if you want or not, depending on your requirement. And these files are automatically somehow available in the cloud for your application to be executed. Also exploit kind of dynamic caching mechanism if you want to exploit those files in a site that is not keeping the data in a reliable way. For example, from the automation and exploiting of scalability of resources, we are providing kind of solution in order to let the services exploit how much resources they need with a kind of automatically monitoring system. So you don't need anymore to ask by yourself in order to get more resources, but the services is monitoring, and if it consume all the CPU available, you will get new CPU if you have configuring the system to scale up to a given limit. So you can just provide to the web interfaces the limit that you want to pay, like from 5 CPU to 50, 100 CPU, and then the system will automatically scale up to that limit, depending on your configuration. This is already available for Condor, Torque, or even Apache Mesos cluster. That is something very high level that exploits the possibility to provide services together with the application. And you will see about those features and technology in the afternoon presentation about PaaS layer specifically. We are also working a lot in terms of providing AI features. Mostly all the people come with a home account, like your home EDP or your social account. So we are willing to provide all the users with their own account, an account in our cloud platform. So you may end up with the SAML, OpenAD Connect, IS-509 credentials. And we can harmonize all those credentials and let you exploit all the cloud services that we have in the portfolio in a very transparent way. But centrally, you can define things like membership or authorization for exploit some services, etc. So this is very flexible from the user perspective point of view, but you can easily access already available services, for example, that are not able to understand an OpenAD Connect account. This is done by Indigo itself, and there is the specific services that is able to do this kind of translation automatically. I will not go in too much details about the storage itself, but what I want to stress here is the fact that we can provide now, together with the quality of services, the capability to provide data lifecycle management. Like I have those data that I want to analyze for the next 6 months, but after 1 year, they are not needed anymore for my analysis. I can store those data in a tape and then, for example, make it open data automatically. So all those kind of changing of quality of service is automatically dealt by the system if you configure that way. and this is named Data Lifecycle Management. Oh, fortunately, here there are some problems with the translation, but anyway, you can see the slide in your PDF file if you download from the web. Anyway, looking into the very higher layer, basically we deal about the possibility to build your own gateway or your own portlet in a gateway, because we are providing REST APIs, toolkit, and obviously an already available front end that you can use in order to push the portlet. But obviously, this will be very well described in the next slide, so I will not go into much details about that. But I want only to stress, as Roberto mentioned before, that now any kind of capabilities or any kind of features that the platform is enabling is somehow available as a REST API. So you can easily exploit this even in your own already available portal or a workflow manager, etc. We are also building tools in order to do big data analytics, and I guess this will also be part of the discussion you will have in the next days. This is specifically related to the high-performance computing environment. For example, if you have an already available workflow mechanism like Kepler or, I don't know, Taverna or whatever, you can easily plug Indigo features, call it like that, in your workflow, just calling a simple REST API. So that's the very advantages here, because you don't need to implement any kind of specific library or whatever. It's very transparent and straightforward. So let's go to some example of use cases, how this could be put into production. So just to make an example, looking into a workflow system mainly used for bioinformatics community named Galaxy, this is able to deal about the offload of some application into a batch system that is configured automatically under the web interfaces that you see when you log in into the portal. And also at the level of the portal, you are able to deal with the user credential and isolation of the user, whatever. So basically, this is an already available solution. We cannot change it, because obviously this is not part of our project, and we cannot ask them to do a strange configuration on the software. So we need to put this into our platform as transparent as possible, but trying to exploit our features. So this is a typical example. Just don't change the application, just put that into a cloud environment and try to exploit what is already provided by the cloud platform. So what will be provided? A Galaxy web frontend automatically installed and configured, so with a public IP that you can reach on the public web, as they are used to do. So basically, the very end user don't see any changes in their workload. The only things is that someone before, like the group administrator or the sysadmin, should ask to Indigo to deploy those services. But it's not somehow visible from the end user perspective. The interesting part is that we want to deploy together with the web frontend also a batch system underneath that is able to process the data and to run the application in a very transparent way, dealing with the different amount of load that user could put into the system. So if they submit more job, the batch system will increase the number of the nodes automatically. And both the web front end and the worker nodes need to share the same shared file system. And this should be configured automatically. The user don't want to change a bit or to increase the complexity of running this application. So, what is needed? We need to start a template in order to define all those services, to put all together this orchestration of the services. And this is done just once at the develop level, together with the developers from WP5, and as soon as this is already available, the end user could just exploit these services or ask for the transition of a new services, just choosing the template from a web menu and configuring the number of nodes they want to have as limit, upper limit and down limit. So here you see from the left of the picture, here we see that we need to build this kind of Tosca template once, decide how to orchestrate all the services, push this Tosca template and the Docker file into a repository, official repository, and then this is available. An end user could just choose the Tosca template and start up the services from the portal, the future gateway portal that you will see, and then using and exploiting all the layer of the Cloud Indigo platform, these services will be deployed on a given infrastructure as a services with a web front end and together with them a private cluster of worker nodes. We will monitoring the status of that cluster and automatically ask for new resources if this is needed. And the worker nodes will be automatically installed and configured, and they will join the cluster automatically. So what the very end user see, the people in the top of the picture, is only the Galaxy front end as it was before. It can push data using a one data solution that you will see tomorrow, I guess, and those data are automatically available in the Galaxy front end, and so also to the worker nodes, and it will get the data out from as soon as the application is executed, as easy as it was to push the data in. So it's automatically dealing all the complexity of using a cloud infrastructure. So this is related to an already running European project that is building a very complex infrastructure solution based on Mesos, that is a resource sharing Docker solutions, and you will see a lot of details about this in the afternoon. But the example here is that they are already building their infrastructure and they don't want to change this because it's an ongoing project. We plan to push all those services into Indigo as a whole, just providing a new Tosca template that could be stated automatically, exploit a lot of features and the capabilities we are providing to the user. So all the work that they've done is one specific template in our app. And they will get for free the AI part, the data management solution, the auto-scaling of resources, the capability to deal with the brokering of different AIS, etc. This is automatically available also if the platform is already there. We can just put the platform into our solution and just let it run as it was before. So that's the most important approach that we are trying to push to the user community. Okay, this is a graphical example, very similar to what we have already. Maybe I can go. We can go to the conclusion. So we will release our release our software end of July, first day of August, and so that will be available to general public. But a lot of already available services or components are there and could be somehow exploited for testing purposes in a prototype form. And a lot of people in the room are already starting to make some tests with the services and platform, and this will be more true in the next weeks. So please try to look into this services and this approach and give us as much feedback as possible in order to improve our approach, to try to implement better some services in order to fulfill your requirements, or to just try to steer better our way of providing services, because obviously what we really need is feedback from the very user community, because we want to produce something that is somehow usable for you, that you are producing science. It's not for just joking with technology. It's really to try to put in your hands more instrument, more toolkit that you can use in order to provide better science in the future. So we are really willing to have your feedback. So try to push your feedback to the people that will, technical people that will be there in those days, in order to let us improve our approach and our services itself.